Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and good night. Welcome to the Fly With Us podcast. This podcast is bringing the art of conversation, self-love, self-care, mental health care and protection, life lessons, love lessons, and everything in between. Today's topic is going to be getting ready for back to school and beating boredom. I'm Lady Bounce.
And I am A Sleep.
All right, so it's that dreaded back to school. I went to Walmart, and there's six aisles of school supplies.
Pencils, crayons, paper, paper clips, erasers. What else do we need?
Notebooks, lunch boxes, teacher
Kleenex,
gifts.
Sanitizer.
Yes. And I was like, no, I'm not ready.
It seemed like they just got out of school and they already got to go back.
It does feel like
they're going back faster and faster, sooner and sooner. It seemed like we had a whole summer when I was a kid.
Right. Like we didn't go back till after Labor Day. Yeah. We didn't go back to September.
That is right. Now they go right back.
Right. They ain't school in August. Mm-hmm. But then they have these problems because they put them back to school too early. Where like the buildings don't have air or they don't have working water fountains, so then they give them bottled water,
then
but then
they
go
out their calamity days up,
right?
And then we have a crazy winter. Yeah, these are some of the things. Maybe so, they don't want them to forget what they learned all year.
No. I mean, the summer slide, as they call it, it is a thing, but not really, because if you're thinking in terms of the stuff that the kids learned last year, it is not like they, you know, left school and they were brainiacs, so some stuff you're gonna have to reteach when school starts.
They
anyway
do refreshers anyway when they come back.
Exactly.
So I wonder.
And then think
about
the kids who went to summer school,
or think about the kids who go to school like all year round.
Exactly.
So
like I taught in a summer school program for 3 weeks this year.
I did too.
So those poor kids just finished school,
they had a lot of fun
and then go right back. I mean, yeah, like our kids have fun. They went on field trips every Tuesday and Thursday, and we only actually had class Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and it was really fun. It was really hands-on. I really enjoyed it. It's like the first summer school experience where I'm like, I like this. I want to do this again next year. Like, I'm excited.
Yeah.
But then
what happened?
Those poor kids.
No, I think they were excited too.
Well, yeah, I mean, I won't say poor kids,
right?
But those children having to wake up on a day where you're really not supposed to have
but
to
they
wake
woke
up.
They woke up and they have fun in a different way. They learned in a different way.
Right.
Fun and exciting. Not to say they probably didn't have fun before, but hey.
Right. But it was different. And even the kids said it was different because the class sizes only had like 5 or 6 kids. And so one young man who was normally really antsy in class and really busy was like, I like this. Because I feel like I can learn stuff because I'm not so distracted by everything happening around me, which makes me in turn react.
I hope somebody took note of that. Somebody took note of that. Yeah.
I did. And I was like, oh, I'm too bad I won't be your teacher next year. Because he's a good kid. He's
what
really
grade
busy.
Is he in?
He'll be a freshman.
Dang, too bad you won't be his teacher next year. Who knows? You might. Might get another program pop up you can slide in on.
Maybe. But like the kids in this program, they were eighth graders going into ninth grade. So what we were basically doing was giving them a boot camp, if you will, to get them ready for high school. So I was at Meadowdale, and all of the kids in that program are actually going to be Meadowdale students next year. But I told them, I was like, I'm gonna keep up with you. I'm gonna talk to the people up here because I want to know how you do.
I see Lady Bounce expanding on that teaching in another capacity other than just one building and one school. I see that.
Okay, you keep saying
that. I see
that. I like it. Is there some money with it too?
It's in the horizon. Some money coming with it too. You are the money. It's coming. It's coming.
Like this.
I never stopped thinking that. Remember I mentioned that before when you were talking about your one student who you were going to court with and all that.
Yes.
You got a gift for that, you know.
There,
our kids need you. They need you.
Oh,
they need. So I hear what you was doing with your downtime. You did a summer program. I did a summer program as well, and I was happy to do the summer program because we got to do poetry pops. You know, you can't bring popsicles typically to school.
No, not unless you got 455 popsicles.
Yeah, and then summer popsicles, it was pretty fun. And
right.
I got some little people this time. We had some first and second graders, so that was fun.
Yeah, because they still really love school.
Yes, and they really love learning and creating and stuff. And our all the kids do, but the eighth graders, they ready for something.
Right, because
ninth grade, they're ready for ninth grade.
The way that their brains work and the way that their brains are formulated, they want more because they get boreder, they reach boredom faster than little kids.
With the whole generation, it's this Generation Z group. Like,
yes,
they're multitasking, they can do a million things at once. Like, hurry up, give it to us, let's get it, let's go.
Right. And all the time. But that also having that constant influx of media and things actually helps to cause them boredom because they get tired of looking at the phone, but they're so addicted to it, so they keep looking at it. But in actuality, they want something more. Their brains crave more. So you got to do more. It's like this book I read a long time ago called Teach With Like Your Hair Is On Fire.
Come on, tell me more.
So in this book about Teach Like Your Hair Is On Fire, it talks about how the attitude of the teacher shapes the attitude of the student. Okay, so in the book, the teacher, his name is escaping me right this second, but he talks about the way he started his school year and it was really chaotic and he couldn't get the kids to listen and to mind and do anything. And then he started coming up with techniques to make the learning interesting and make it fun in his classroom. So it's like teach like your hair is on fire, because if your hair was on fire, you'd be running around doing some of this and moving a whole lot. So he believes in that. So he talks about, you know, not sitting down, you know, in your classroom. You can't teach sitting down. You can't teach from your seat.
So if he's not sitting down, so how do we get the kids to learn like their hair is on fire? I mean,
I would say that the biggest thing is if you know your content standards, you can use anything to teach those standards. So as teachers, we got to dig deeper, not just use this book they gave us because it's the book they gave you and it's the book they said you have to teach. You got to pull in other stuff that they're interested in. Like, most kids don't care about the Treaty of Versailles. They have no frame of reference for what that is. They don't even really have a frame of reference for the Constitution as it relates to them the way that they are now.
Like, most kids didn't care about poetry, but they like Pac. Pac's a poet.
Exactly.
They like hip hop. They like rap.
You
got
to kind of go
poetry,
you know, around the bend to be able to teach it. Like, I taught, you know, of course you teach reading comprehension, but instead of reading those boring passages that are, you know, in a lot of the textbooks, I pulled up something about the history of the cell phone. And then I pulled up something about, you know, who made the first water gun. These are things that sparked their interest.
So the way you were teaching them, like, the hair is on fire, doing stuff that they like and can relate to.
Exactly.
It makes perfect sense.
Right.
If they interested, then they'll learn it. They'll want
to learn. And they'll be excited about learning it.
And you're making it relevant.
You have to make it relevant.
I like that you're teaching like your hair's on fire.
Especially like now, because I have high school kids. And so some of the social studies curriculum, if you just teach the book the way it is in a book outline, it's very dry. It's very bland. You got to pull stuff in. You got to teach with movies. Oh, this chapter is about slavery. Let me let you watch, you know, 12 Years a Slave, or let's watch, you know, the PBS version of 12 Years a Slave.
Yeah.
You know, without the nudity and the cuss words and stuff
right, the clean version, kid version.
You know, let's look at the documentary. Let's learn about Henry Box Brown. Who was he? Why did he do what he did? How was he able to do what he did?
So it's just, as the cliche or saying goes, we have to make learning fun.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the best way to do that is, the first thing I do, I interview my kids. Like, the first 2 weeks of school.
I do like a sheet, who am I kind of
thing. Like, the first 2 weeks of school, I don't teach anything. We're not pulling out a book. We're not pulling out paper.
Yeah,
I'm getting to know them. They're getting to know me. I'm teaching them procedures, you know, so the classroom can run and they can, you know, run the classroom. And as they're talking, I'm always ear hustling. Uh-huh. I'm always listening. I'm like, oh, did she say she like? Okay, he like it too. Okay. Uh-huh. So now I'm like, oh, well, they'll be good partners if we play a game or we do an activity uh-huh. tomorrow because they have similar interests.
See, that's how we learn too, listening and watching right. them, and they the same way. We got to remember that these kids require the same things that we do. Yeah, when we're teaching and expecting them to learn something. But okay, so we making it relevant,
right?
Making sure it's interesting to them, making sure they're having fun. Now, what about? Let's go back to where we at. We got to get back to school. So everybody's having fun right now. How do we switch gears? I'm talking about mommy, daddy, auntie, uncle, grandma, all the kids having fun. Everybody got to get back on board and get ready to get back on the bus and get back to school. So what do we do? How do we switch gears to get back?
Well, depending on the age of your children, I think the first thing you should do is probably have a family meeting. Mm. And say, hey, school starts back up. Our schedules are going to be this way or that way, or this is going to happen or that's mm-hmm. going to happen. And let the kids know what the expectations are. So they aren't blindsided. Like, oh, mm-hmm. your bus is going to come at 7:15. That means you have to be out of the house by 7.
Which means you can't stay up till 11. Exactly. You can't stay up till 11 no more. We got to start going to bed a little earlier to prepare you for this.
And then, you know, think about... plan out the logistics for how it's gonna work. Daddy's gonna take Johnny to school. Mommy's gonna take Tiffany to school. Daddy's mm-hmm. gonna pick Tiffany up, but mommy's gonna pick Johnny up when she gets off mm-hmm. work. You know, this kid has soccer practice or has to go here. So you definitely need a family calendar. You gotta mm-hmm. plan that stuff out. And everybody puts their stuff on the calendar so we
need to include, do we have daycare providers out here? Do we have jobs to go to?
Right.
Even the kids, we gotta get all that planned so that everybody is on the same page.
Right.
And that will make for a stress-free transition, right?
Absolutely.
Pretty cool.
And then talk about the kind of things you could do to make your mornings easier, like laying your clothes out the night before. Depending yeah. on the age of your child, take your shower the night before. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, lay out your clothes, pack your book bag, pack your lunch the night before.
Eat breakfast. Time to eat breakfast. Hello? Make time to eat breakfast.
I saw the greatest breakfast thing ever.
What was it?
It's a real breakfast. It's called a...
It's a real breakfast.
Right. But it's called a breakfast scramble. And they have different varieties. But the one we eat, of course, is turkey because we don't eat beef and pork. Uh-huh. But in this little cup, and they sell them at Walmart and Kroger.
Okay.
They sell them in the refrigerator section. Mm-hmm. So you get this cup. In the cup, there's a little pack of turkey sausage, little pack of cheese, little pack of onions and peppers. Uh-huh. You put all of that in a cup. You crack an egg. Put the egg in there. Stir it up. You put it in the microwave for 40 seconds. Uh-huh. And there you go.
Okay.
It's a real breakfast.
You know what else you can do? You can go get your muffin pan that you got somewhere in here. Right?
Do I have a muffin pan?
And you can cut up your peppers. Y'all can do that together as a family night activity. Right. Cut up your peppers, your onions, and your sausage, and you put them all in the little cups after you grease them, the little muffin pan parts, and the egg, and then you bake it, and then you have a lot of little breakfast scramble bites, like muffin bites
with no bread. That.
And then you can put them in baggies, and then you have that pop in the microwave,
walk out the
and
door.
You know what's in there because you prepared it.
I like that.
So you could do that.
I like that. And it's probably more cost effective doing it that
Absolutely.
Way than buying like the breakfast scramble cracker egg things, because they are about a dollar and something a piece.
Yeah, because we need those dollars for them pencils and crayons Hello? And paper and folders and all that stuff,
right? And that yeah. that laundry list of school supplies that mm-hmm. the school sends home, and you just go, whoa,
that I don't think the kids ever really use.
Well, it depends on, I think it depends on the grade.
Yeah.
So, like, kindergarten, they use everything mm-hmm. that's on that school supply list.
I always love those big old crayons.
Right.
That the little people get to use.
The little Now, when learners. You get to high school, I would say kindergarten and high school, they typically use everything that's on the mm-hmm. list. It's those elementary grades, like fourth, fifth grade.
I found that sometimes they have, that the teachers have them get so much stuff. Well, I know when my kids went to Trotwood Prep, this was the case. They would have them get so many supplies, and then my son said that they would use them, the extras, for those who didn't have supplies. So
that's a neat idea.
Yeah, that kind of worked out. I thought that was pretty okay. Cool.
I always thought, you know, being a teacher myself, you know, I have oodles and oodles of supplies. So I typically don't have to go buy school supplies for my kids every year because I go to like the teacher shopping days and, you know, free stores and stuff to get school supplies. But I always end up having to buy tissue, hand sanitizer, like Ziploc bags, you know, like the extra stuff that they make you have. I do struggle though when a school supply list comes home and it has all name brand products.
Well,
I see why it is done.
Why?
I fully understand it.
Why?
It is done because, say my mama can afford Crayola. Your mama can only afford Crazy Art. It is a status thing. Believe it or not.
Don't think so. I've used Crazy Art crayons myself and Crayola. Crayola colors better.
for you, but for kids, it really is.
It really
does matter. And you would think that something so trivial as it's a crayon color with it, but I have seen kids like say stuff to other kids like, "Yo, mama bought you generic crayons." Like, I got crayons that color. You know, so it is. So I get why teachers say, you know, it has to be Crayola. And then sometimes they put them in like a big community bucket of crayons. And so everybody is able to grab the same crayon, the same color, the same brand and everything. But one thing I don't think they take into account is that I might be a struggling parent.
Well, for the parents that are comfortable saying that they are struggling, struggle no more. Walmart and everybody else will have a sale.
Sure enough.
It's going to be like 25 cent and 8 cent boxes of crayon.
Yes.
Catch those sales. Take advantage of those sales. Do your homework. Do your homework.
Yes.
Find out how to get more bang for your buck so that you're not out here stressing on how to make it happen for your kids.
You're like my cousin. She's in a coupon.
Come on. Use your Facebook marketplace.
I swear they are. And she posted on Facebook all the time. And in fact, it's funny that you mentioned about catching the sales because three of the people in her group I'm friends with on Facebook. So I see them all posting.
Yeah.
So one of them goes to Staples and buys everything from Staples, you know, that's cheap and on sale. My friend, Janessa, she'll go to Kroger and she'll buy all the Kroger stuff that they have on sale. And then their other friend, Tiffany, will go to like Office Depot and buy what's on sale. And then they get together and they swap the supplies. And I'm like, that's a neat idea. So instead of me having to go to three different stores, I can hit all the sales.
Yeah.
And, you know, basically from the comfort of my home. I'm like, that's awesome.
And also take advantage of your community resources. I believe they're going to be doing it big soon here in the park at Broadway Park, as they always do. Do it big for the kids. I think it's going to be around the couple of days after school starts, like around August the 11th. Don't quote me on that yet, but look for the back to school events that will be coming up. There'll be book bag giveaways and stuff like that.
Everybody's giving away stuff.
So there is no excuse why you can't get the support you need, because help is already here and on the way. We just got to take advantage of it.
And the biggest tip, don't wait to the last minute. Don't go posting on Facebook 3 days before school starts, "Oh, I need school supplies," because you've had all summer. School happens every year at the same time.
So look for your list. It's coming in the mail, your supplies list. If not, go online and find your school site, and you'll more than likely see the school supplies list there. For your high schoolers and middle schoolers, don't forget the little ladies. They may need some hygiene stuff as well as the boys, but the little ladies might be coming into that time, that season. Prepare for these things so that you don't have to be stressed out about too much.
And some things are basic. So even if you don't have the school supply list, you know your child's going to need pencils. You know they're going to need folders. You know that they're going to need crayons and glue and scissors. You know, depending on the age, some stuff you just kind of already know. Like, I already know from my high schooler, she's going to need highlighters and index cards. So before I even get her list, and I know she's going to need folders, and they're got to be color-coded. So
if nothing else, we'll take a notebook and pencil to school the first day of school And we know that we can get everything else we need after that. But
oh, yeah. Because they have crazy sales after school starts because they do recognize that people wait to the last minute or school supply lists aren't available right away. So, again, check them sales papers.
Just like the Halloween candy, y'all. Look for them sales. So you can get more.
I knew you was going to bring it back to some sugar somehow. I just, like, you went the whole show and didn't mention sugar. I knew that sugar was coming from somewhere. I knew.
Shout out to Derek Williams for that. It's hot in July workout. I needs that. I've been eating. I'll be doing some extra jumping of ropes tonight. So we're going to go ahead. Now that we know we're ready for back to school, we've been maximizing our downtime with preparing to get back to school.
Yes.
But let's be mindful of what we are here for while you're flying with us. Let's get back to this self-care. And this is the Mindfulness Minute. Oh, we were just talking about this. One of the things that we can do. I was about to say cook at home. I guess I'm hungry, y'all. Make an appointment for a physical. Do not forget, we got physicals that need to be taken care of. Some of us might have done them for the summer jobs, youth works program or something like that. If not, your 7th and 8th graders need MMRs, what is it, DTAP, all and these other things.
Yes.
So make an appointment for a physical. The most important indulgence in life is to take care of your body. It is the only one you have and you must take care of it. Get a yearly tune-up to ensure everything is working properly. Many people are nervous about doctors and therefore skip these crucial appointments. However, they should be looked at as you moments. So make sure that you take the time to make an appointment for a physical, not only for your children, but also for yourself, right? So
I like it.
Do that.
I have an eye appointment next week, as a matter of fact.
I need to make an appointment for new glasses. I broke these. Get that eye appointment, girl. Get that eye appointment. So do that, and then we're going to move on over to our self-care. That was the Mindfulness Minute. And this one is tackle a simple project. You don't have to walk into this back-to-school situation thinking, I got to do this, I got to do that, I got to do it. Just do a little bit at a time.
Right.
You might not think of tackling a project as self-care, but sometimes checking something off a long-standing to-do list is very satisfying. To facilitate getting small projects done in your spare time, make a list of the little projects that need to be done around your home. Select uncomplicated jobs you've been wanting to tackle, but just haven't been able to find the time for. Here are some suggestions. Clean your desk or area where you store paperwork. Ooh, I need to do that. Organize and clean an attic, garage, or basement. Go through that out-of-control linen closet or your grandmother's hope chest, or sort through a small drawer full of letters and papers. Last one, if a little bit of redecorating appeals to you, choose a color and paint one of the smaller rooms in your house. Paint it the color of success. You will succeed, you will be prepared, and you will get to hear from Lady Bounce in a second. It is time for our brain science.
All right, so while we have a little bit of summer left, a popular thing I know that parents hear a lot, I'm bored. It ain't nothing to do. And then you have parents who scramble like crazy to help your child not be bored. I don't want him to be bored, because if he's bored, he's going to do something crazy. If he's bored, he's going to do this. So I'm going to give you the brain science behind boredom and tell you why boredom is actually really good for your child.
Interesting. Do tell, young lady.
Do tell. So, boredom has benefits. It's important to see boredom as a call to action. Boredom can be a catalyst for action. It can provide an opportunity for thought and reflection. It can also be a sign that a task is a waste of time and not worth continuing. Boredom encourages people to explore because it signals that your current situation is lacking something. So it's kind of a push to seek out something new. If you allow yourself to daydream, then you are allowing yourself a chance to make positive connections. If you find yourself without any great ideas, try boring yourself even more by answering emails or doodling on paper.
I like this.
So here's some bullet point tips. Boredom sparks creativity.
Yes.
Your brain is searching for neurostimulation when it's bored. Mm-hmm. So it encourages you to think outside the box, if you will.
I like it.
So there's no other way of getting stimulation. So you have to go into your head. You may be surprised by what you come up with when you do.
You're creating.
Boredom is good for your mental health. Daydreaming can be quite a respite and provide a brief escape from your day-to-day life. It is also beneficial to simply step away from screens, work, and other stressors long enough to feel bored. Studies have shown, for example, that modern tools, including work email, social media, and dating apps, can strain your mental health. So taking a break can be a valuable opportunity to recharge.
Unplug and recharge.
So, how to be bored the right way. It is important not to conflate boredom with relaxation. A purposeful, tranquil activity such as yoga or meditation likely does not meet the definition of trying and failing to find stimulation. Mm-hmm. To tap into true boredom, pick an activity that requires little to no concentration, like walking a familiar route, swimming laps, or even just sitting with your eyes closed and simply letting your mind wander without music or stimulation to guide it. So sit and be silent and see where your mind goes. Which actually, on our Facebook page, that was a self-care assignment from last week, to take 10 minutes off and let your mind wander. And I did that, and I came up with some good ideas. Like,
I know, you sent me a picture of that. You was doing it.
I know, right? So the next time you find yourself in a grocery store in a tedious meeting or killing time in a waiting room, resist the urge to scroll through your phone. You are bound to get bored, and so are your children. Your brain, mood, and work performance just might improve when you allow your brain to rest.
Always stay creative. I love it. I love it. I love it. Rest that brain.
I like that. But I don't mind being bored. Like, I thought I was going to be bored because our internet went out and I was like, oh my God, what am I going to do? But I've been so productive.
But you, exactly.
I went through my clothes. I got rid of clothes that don't fit. I have like clothes that have to be washed on gentle cycle that don't get washed on the norm because I don't have time to gentle cycle wash my clothes. So they get put to the side. They get worn. They get put to the side because now they need to be washed and they just sit there. And then I'd be like, that man.
So productive. You unplugged.
Right. So I washed all my gentle cycle clothes and then realized like I found like 5 shirts I had been looking for.
it was shopping day.
Right. They were like in the gentle cycle pile. I'm like, I could have been wearing this. Mm-hmm. I found my favorite sweater. I thought I had thrown it away when we moved stuff around. And I was like, it was in the gentle cycle pack all along.
Gentle cycle pack.
I know, but I'm ready for next school year already. I am prepared because all my gentle cycle clothes are clean and they smell fresh.
I'm gonna go and get prepared. I'm gonna go and go through my clothes. If it doesn't fit the way that I like right now, it's out the door.
I like that idea. I think I'm gonna try that.
Yeah, I'm gonna go and do that. Yeah,
because that would definitely declutter a space.
Yeah, I declutter a space. I gotta make room for all the new stuff that's coming in this school year, right? So I can be prepared to do the work. Yeah, so we're getting ready to go back to school, y'all. We've maximized our downtime. We have clearly determined that it's okay to be bored.
Yes.
And when your kids are fussing and going through the motions and complaining, in some cases, they may not be, I don't believe in bad kids, just bored ones. Mm-hmm. Be creative. Let's find some different ways to tackle these things and meet them head on.
I like it.
And I am, you can find us first of all on Facebook,
Instagram,
YouTube,
SoundCloud,
and you can Twitter, and you can email us at flywithusla@gmail.com. Thank you for flying with us. Remember to first love yourself. I am Ace Slate.
I'm Lady Bounce.
And we out here.
We out.